So, wow, that's really loud. I'll turn that down. I'll put this way over here. Welcome here. Welcome to everybody who's seen this on YouTube or Facebook. And once again, we're back with masks on. And we've got the ribbons back up. It's just the reality of where we are. But the good news is Jesus hasn't changed. The gospel hasn't changed. God is the same today, yesterday, and forever. Let's come before his presence and worship him. And we will give this service as an offering that ascends to his throne room. And then we're going to take some time to listen to what he has to say to us. And we want to be good soil so that he can plant his seeds of truth in us, and that those seeds of truth can be fruitful. And here it's harvest season. We know all about being fruitful. And we're looking forward to seeing the fruit that God is going to display in our lives and in this community. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for Onaway Baptist Church, for the people who aren't here, for the people who are watching over the internet and listening over the radio, for the ability we have to share our service with so many people. Pray for Brian and Celia, and I pray especially for healing for Celia, and that she could get out of the hospital tomorrow morning. And I pray for your kingdom to come here on earth as it is in heaven. And there's so many ways that it isn't here, but we look forward to what you're going to continue to do. Thank you for this chance to worship you, for this chance to stop and think about who you are and what you've done. So we dedicate this time to you, and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning to everybody who's watching or listening remotely. And I pray and I would ask that we all stand to worship.
Thank you. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God.
Please bow with me for congregational prayer. Heavenly Father, we come together this morning to praise you and to worship you. You are holy and sovereign over all. You are our refuge, our fortress, our shelter in times of storm, and you are trustworthy. Lord, as a congregation, we look to you for wisdom and guidance. We ask that you would watch over us and our community. This morning, we pray a special blessing on our church family of the week, the Keyson family. We pray for Jason and Trina and their children, Caleb, Connor, and Tessa. We thank you for this lovely family and the bright smiles and enthusiasm they bring to this church. We ask for a blessing on their marriage, their family, and the relationships with friends and neighbors this week. May we as a church body keep them in our prayers. Heavenly Father, we ask you for your guidance in these uncertain times. COVID is another challenge we have to persevere through. The world today seems to be full of questions with few answers. Lord God, we declare you are the answer. You are the first and the last, the Alpha and the Omega, unchanging and eternal. May we fix our eyes upon you. How do we, as followers of Christ, persevere? Your word says we are loved, we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our mind, and to love our neighbors as ourselves. Lord, we ask you to love our neighbors this week and be your hands and your feet. We pray for our neighbors at the chateau who are in the midst of an outbreak. We pray for our schools, the administrators, the teachers, the bus drivers, the students, and the parents. We pray for our health system, for the doctors, the nurses, the patients, and the families, and all those that are affected at this time. We pray, and we pray for our community, our neighbors, our co-workers, our family members, and our relationships with them. Our relationships are to be full of love and a testimony to you. If necessary, Lord, we repair and reconcile our relationships with others, and as always, we pray that you strengthen and deepen them. Heavenly Father, there are many more prayer items within our congregation. May we be a church of prayer as we watch over each other and encourage each other. Let us now pray out loud together as a body of believers our Lord's prayer as he taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. For offering today, we will be doing it a little bit differently. We will just have the plates at the back, and as you leave later this morning, you can deposit your tithes and offerings. And I'll pray for the offering at this time. Heavenly Father, thank you for your provision. Thank you for taking care of all of our needs. Lord, as we give you offering today, whether it is this money or time or prayer, Lord, we ask that you bless it and multiply it. Lord, for the funds that you provide this church, may we be dutiful with them. May we be discerned where they are to go. And may they build your kingdom. And Lord, we just ask that you bless all those that are able to give, whether it is time, money, or other resources. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I thank you that even in the midst of challenge, that you are still the same yesterday and today and forever.
Amen.
And I pray that everything that I say would be filtered through your Spirit and through grace, and that it would fall on good soil, and that the stuff that I say that isn't from you would be discarded, but what you've asked me to say, that it would produce good fruit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we're doing a series on parables, and I kind of casually said, hey, Brian, I could probably preach something on worship or something. And he's like, good, you're done. Good, you're on. And you get to do new wine and new wineskins. And so lots of times this has been used in the context of the worship wars. When I was a kid, all we sang was hymns. Oh no, there was a few choruses or praise choruses. And my church actually had the green hymnal and a new hymnal that had it was a praise chorus book, and it was three ring binder, so you could add new ones. And so was it in the new book or the old book? And the new book, of course. Now with the explosion of the worship music industry, we get new songs weekly, and there's no time to print it in books, but we have the internet for that. So there's new wine and new wineskins has been this analogy for, oh, you're just such a fuddy-duddy, and you're stuck in the old ways, and all you have is the old wine. And as Jesus says at the end, once you've had the old wine, you don't want the new wine. Because the aged stuff is the good stuff. And we'll see how that works out. I'm not going to talk too much about the worship wars. I'll bring it up again in a few minutes. But we're going to talk about the parable and what Jesus really meant. Parables are stories that Jesus told to make a point. He revealed things to people, and yet he hid them. So they, my brother's been listening to the Bible Project, and he said that a podcast about the Bible Project, and they talk a lot about why is the Bible so hard to understand, and the guy who's in charge of the Bible Project, which is a series of YouTube videos explaining the Bible. And they have hours and hours of discussion for every minute of a YouTube video that they produce. But he said that the Bible is really an invitation to meditate. It calls you in to spend time thinking about what it says. It doesn't just directly go out and tell you what to think, what to do. And that's consistent. Jesus was like that. When he walked around on this earth, people would ask him a question and should have an easy answer, and he would answer with a question, or he would answer with a story. He very rarely said, this is what you're supposed to do. When he did say, this is what you're supposed to do, like to the young ruler, he said, go sell everything you have, give it all to the poor, come follow me. Oh my goodness! Can we just go back to stories, please? Because that's a little extreme. This is one particular, well, two parables that we're going to talk about, but they have the same theme, they have the same message. When I was in high school, in grade 9 and grade 12, I had the same English teacher for both those years. He was a genius. He was a fantastic teacher. And it turns out he was not too great at life, and then he got MS. So I saw him years later. I don't know if he's still alive, but he isn't the guy that I would choose as a model for how to live life, but as far as teaching English literature, he was fantastic, taught me a ton. And I don't think this sermon follows his outline for how to write an essay, but most of my essays from grade 9 onward, it was just fill in the blanks, because I knew exactly how to write an essay that would get a good mark right through university and Bible school. He talked about poetry in grade 12, and he said, this is how you recognize poetry, there's three things. One is poetry is indirect. It's not, I walked through a field and saw some grass and saw some trees. You might say that, but that's not what you mean. Poetry is always something deeper. It's indirect. It's saying something in order to say something else. He also said poetry is musical. In our English language, poetry usually rhymes. But even if it doesn't rhyme, if it's free verse, there's a rhythm to it. There's a way that it leads to a climax and a resolution, but it's musical. It draws you in and keeps you going. In the Old Testament, in the Psalms, they did their music not with rhyme. How would we know? We don't know the language. But with parallelism. So they would say something and then they'd say it again a different way. Two different, usually indirect ways of saying the same thing. So they always are musical. The third thing he says is that poetry is always about people. Even when it's about flowers and stars, it's always about what's in our hearts. It's always about how we perceive things. It's always about how we understand things and what we experience. So poetry is indirect, poetry is musical, poetry is people talk. Jesus quoted poetry sometimes. Isaiah 61 is a poem. But he usually used parables, which are not poetry, they're a story. But again, I thought about it, that same kind of model. How do we recognize a parable? And the first thing is that it's the same, is that it's indirect, just like poetry. A parable says something, but it's talking about something else. It talks about a father and the son takes his inheritance and runs away, but he's really talking about us and our relationship with God. It talks about seeds that are planted in the ground and grow, and he's really talking about the Bible. He's talking about the message of the Bible and how it gets into our hearts. So it's always indirect. Poetry, instead of being people talk directly, is actually kingdom talk. I mean, poetry, parables. Parables are kingdom talk. They definitely are talking about people, but they're also talking about God, and they're describing almost every parable is either explicitly or implicitly a description of what the kingdom of God is like. Many times Jesus said, the kingdom of God is like a pearl of great price. The kingdom of God is like a treasure hidden in a field. So, when we hear Jesus talk about tell a story, or even just a word picture, he's talking about what is the kingdom? Now, we're in the middle of a democratic election, and we're going to collectively, as the citizenship of Canada, make a choice tomorrow. However that turns out, are there good choices? That's the way that government works. We're also a constitutional monarchy under the Queen. Now, it used to be that the King or Queen had a lot more power than the Prime Minister did. It's probably a good thing that it's not a monarchy, a full monarchy anymore. I am happy to be in the country I am, despite its faults. But the thing about being a monarchy is that you're actually not loyal to the country. The country is an abstract entity. You're loyal to the person. And through feudalism, your loyalty was personal, up to the person in charge of your little area, whatever the noble was, who was also personally loyal to the person in charge of a larger area, a duke or something like that, who was then personally loyal to the king. So when the king said, I want to go to war, the people who were personally loyal to him said, well, we're with you. So we will go to war with you. And then they said to the people that are personally loyal to them, we're going to war. I need you to come with me. And then they would go and talk to the people under them, and eventually it would go down to the guy who was just about to put in his crop. And he would say, you got someone else to put in your crop, or else you're not going to put in the crop because we're going to war. You got to get your war horse, unhook him from the plow, put the big war saddle on, and come fight. It was personal loyalty. And so the kingdom of the King of England extended as far as the personal loyalty did, and no further. If there was one of those dukes that said, no, I'm out, I don't agree with this war, I'm friends with the guy that you're going to war with, or I think this is a waste of time, money, or my guys need to put their crop in, can't go, then the kingdom didn't extend inside that duke's realm. And so feudalism is an endless series of people trying to change the relationships of individual people, which would then filter down. And that made a lot of sense there. It's different now. I mean, since nationalism arose, things changed. But whenever I think about the kingdom of God, I have to try and go back to that world. The kingdom of God is a place that extends as far as the personal loyalty of the citizens to the king. So what's it like if a whole bunch of people are personally loyal to the king? Wow, I'm off on a little bit of a tangent that isn't in my notes. The United States Constitution is treated within the United States as almost sacred writing. It's almost inspired. They pledge allegiance to the Constitution of the United States and to the government that it flows from that. Which, instead of pledging allegiance to a person, they made up a set of rules for how they figure a country should run, and said, we're going to be not a person who can just change their mind at any moment. We're going to be loyal to a set of rules. Now, they said that the people of the United States are above the Constitution and that they can change it if they follow a certain number of procedures, and there have been a bunch of amendments to the Constitution, but they are loyal to the Constitution. And the Constitution, other than amendments, which haven't happened in a long time, that's pretty static. It doesn't really change. So their personal loyalty isn't to another person. It's to, this is how we do things. And that has crept into our thinking about the kingdom of God. So Jesus came to Israel, time of the Roman Empire. The only personal loyalty that was allowed within the realm of the Roman Empire was loyalty to Caesar. And saying Jesus is Lord, as Christians did in the New Testament, was a direct repudiation of that ultimate loyalty. Because without, if you're loyal to Jesus, then you're not loyal to Caesar. And when Caesar says, we're going to go to war, we say, well, I have to check with Jesus first. Remember when, some of you might remember when Kennedy was running for president. I obviously don't remember that, but I read about it. And he's Catholic. And they said, well, wait a minute, the Pope's going to say, don't do that. And he's going to have to say, oh, wait, am I loyal to the Constitution or to the Pope? And what's no problem if you're just loyal to God, because of course God is blessing the United States, but the Pope might have a different opinion. And Biden is a Catholic in some sense right now. So the president, that they kind of said, no, it's okay, you know what, my religion is a private matter. It actually doesn't affect anything. Which says that my loyalty to God extends only within, kind of just a little bit. Which means, says something about their loyalty. Jesus came into Israel, and he was surrounded by people who said, well, okay, we're not loyal to the king because David isn't on the throne right now, or the sons of David aren't on the throne. So we're going to be loyal to a set of rules. And the Pharisees detailed a long list of very specific rules. This is how to run a country. Very specifically, this is how to live within this country. And if you're loyal to a set of rules that don't change, then life is very simple. You just follow the rules. But it's very rigid, and it's hard to adjust. You are saying that this is the answer, and the answer is the book is finished, the box is closed, and we're going to live inside that box. So Jesus came, and very near the beginning of his ministry, he showed up and went to this wedding. And, I mean, probably he enjoyed himself. It was a celebration. God is a God of joy and love. And then he turned water into wine as a blessing to this particular wedding, but as a sign of what he was going to do. And then this story, or this little word picture that he threw in later, obviously has refers back, or has a reference to his miracle of turning water into wine. When they said to him, John's disciples often fast and pray, and so do the disciples of the Pharisees, but yours go on eating and drinking. He's saying, the question is, wait a minute. We have a set of rules. We know how to obey God. We know how to behave in these different situations. And one of them is, we fast, we discipline ourselves, we mourn. And he says, well, everything's new. The bridegroom is here. When the bridegroom is here, we're not fasting. It's disrespectful to go to a wedding and say, no, I'm not eating, I'm fasting and mourning and not celebrating with you. Jesus said, no, this is the time to celebrate. And throughout the New Testament, we are looking forward to when he comes again, and we will celebrate together. So now, maybe is a time where we can still fast, because in some of his other stories, the master goes away and then comes back. So we're waiting for him to come back.
Amen.
All right. So, wine. I'm not a vintner. I believe that's the word. The guy who makes wine. But remember that back in the day, they didn't have glass jars. Glass was incredibly valuable because they didn't really know how to make it. So they had wine skins. They used leather. And if you put wine in, new wine, into a new leather bag, the wine is still fermenting. It's not completely finished. It's processed. And that process leads to its expansion. There's going to be chemistry going on inside the wine. It's going to want to grow. The leather bag, if it's new leather, still has some give in it. So that works together. And I mean, this is sort of the obvious. It has to be true for the story to work, and the story works. So this is what turns out that's true. You want to put new wine in new wineskins. You want to put old wine. You can put old wine in old wineskins. You can pour them from one old wineskin to another. It's fine. God, or Jesus is saying here that God's doing a new thing.
Amen.
Now it's been 2,000 years. Did Jesus give one type of new wine, put it in a new wineskin, and then let it sit there and get old for 2,000 years? Or is he making a different statement about newness? I want to introduce yet one more word picture before I finally start connecting all the dots here. I got Starlink internet. I'm very excited. It's much better than ExploreNet. It's much better than MCSNet. It's all of the other options, and I researched all of them and tried as many as I could. TELUS Hub. Starlink has a dish that points just a little bit south of straight up. And I tried to get a picture on the screen for you, but the live website that shows where the satellites are takes a lot of work for the computer to deal with that, and it just about crashed everything. So let's just leave it for now. But if you want to go to starlink.sx, it has a picture. You can't work, it doesn't work on your phone, but on a computer, it shows the satellites going over top. And so here's Alberta, and we're in a lane where satellites are going over top of, around just about right over top of Edmonton, maybe a little south. And they keep crossing from BC to Saskatchewan. And at any given time, there's between 2 and 3 satellites over top of Alberta. It takes 1 minute and 10 seconds for the satellite to go from one border to the next, from Alberta, from BC to Saskatchewan, across all of Alberta, 70 seconds. And so my internet is constantly seeing this one, connecting to it, okay, it got, okay, now it's getting out, oh, there's another one, connecting to the next one, oh, it's, and then there's the next one, and it's every 30 seconds or so. 25 seconds, something like that. There's a base station in northern Montana. They apparently haven't got permission to build base stations in Canada yet. So the internet, for me, it comes from my house up to the satellite and then down to Montana and then to the rest of the internet. My house and the base station, we don't change. The satellites just keep coming over top over and over and over again. I saw that, I think of that, and I think of what it's like as human culture changes. Again and again and again, we have different changes. Every generation, it's not 70 seconds, it might be 40 years. There's a new cultural shift. And some of us have gone through 2 different cultures, some of us have gone maybe 4, you know? And it kind of feels like you've lived through 4 different ages. And when I think of what it was like without electricity, add electricity, add television, add the internet, and now in this world of social media, I mean, and it feels also like things are accelerating, but there's this constant stream of culture that changes, and there's a base station that's the gospel. And it doesn't change. It stays where it is. So,
amen.
What is culture? I took an introductory anthropology course, so I'm an expert. You know, I took it, 30 years ago or so, I took an introductory anthropology course. And it told me there that culture is how humans survive in the world. And every culture that exists is successful because the humans that practice it are alive. So cultures are all successful to a point. But we know, because we read the Bible, that cultures are all broken. They're a product of human ingenuity and relationships. And every culture that comes along, people see it and say, oh, that part's good, but wow, is it ever broken right there? And then they try and fix it. So right now our culture is trying to adjust and fix racism. And we're still trying to deal with gender identity and how do we respond to different gender expressions. Our culture is having those discussions, and those are all, I mean, every one of those arguments or discussions has a history from other choices that the culture has made previously. It all comes down to human choices, and we understand that most of those choices come as a result of sin, in response to sin. And humans try their best to come up with a way of living together that has justice, that has fairness, that, but, I mean, it still allows me to get what I need. And so there's a lot of selfishness. Culture keeps changing, and it keeps changing because humans keep changing it in response to the mistakes that it has made. So, yes, every new iteration that comes over the horizon and comes to us is better in some way than the one before. But often, because humans are broken, those fixes are also broken, maybe in a different area. There's a lot of unintended consequences. The gospel is always good. The gospel is not broken. The gospel always has the right answer for the problems of every culture that comes along. Okay, so what is the gospel? I'm just going to go through it quickly. Jesus died to pay the penalty for our sin. That says a lot of things right there. We have sin. There's a penalty for it. That penalty comes because God is just. God is not willing to allow sin to go unpunished. There is this innate drive for fairness. God is the cause, the originator of that. There needed to be a penalty paid, and God sent his Son to take the penalty. Jesus rose from the dead. He demonstrated his victory over sin and death. He has given us hope that life extends beyond death. So our family members that have died are not gone. They're with God. And we're going to get to see them again. When the paralytic was dropped through the ceiling in front of Jesus, and the Pharisees were watching, he says, "Son, your sins are forgiven." And he read their minds. He says, which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to say stand up and walk? Well, it's easy to talk, right? So he said, stand up and walk and up you go. Which demonstrates that he had the authority on earth to forgive sins. He's very explicit about that. When he rose from the dead, he demonstrated that he wasn't just talking.
Amen.
He had the authority. He has the authority.
Amen.
To forgive our sins. Then Jesus said, the kingdom of God is at hand. And his resurrection and his ascension kicked off the church's role in bringing the kingdom to the earth. We're supposed to demonstrate our personal loyalty to our king in our sphere of influence so that more and more of the world is run the way God wants it to be run. So that more and more people are invited into the sphere of personal loyalty to the king, where there is justice and where there is forgiveness. And then God is inviting us in, and he's saying, I want to give you so many blessings. The whole history of the Old Testament is God really, really wanting to bless the nation of Israel so they could be assigned to the peoples of the world. And they consistently turned away from his blessings because they didn't trust, because it doesn't make any sense. God's rules, God's directions require us to trust in God, and it's easier to just, let's just do this, which is obvious and gives us what we want right now. And the New Testament is an invitation to do that individually. All of us are our own little nation of Israel that are supposed to be assigned to the people of the world. And we as a church, collectively, are supposed to be a community that demonstrates to the world what the kingdom of God, what it looks like when people are personally loyal to God and God blesses them because we are part of His kingdom. God has given us the ability to choose. That's part of the gospel, that we can choose to accept Him as our Lord and our Savior. He gives us the dignity of that choice. He could just have made us like the angels and said, you know, you get one choice and that's it. But no, He allows us to continue to make choices. He's made us in His image, image bearers in the world, to demonstrate again, to be God's agents in the world, to rule. We were supposed to rule the way He wants us to. In all of this, the gospel is that God wants to have a relationship with you. He wants you to experience God's love for you.
Amen.
So that is consistent. And how we express it has changed many times. We are an expression, we're trying to be an expression of God's kingdom on earth. But our expression as a church is also full of humanity. Because of the dignity that God gives us to make choices, we also make mistakes here in church. So we want to do church the way God wants us to, and continually new churches are found and say, oh, we're going to do it the New Testament way now. This is going to be a New Testament style church. This is going to be the way God wants us to do church. All those traditions, we're going to leave them behind, and we're just going to go back to what God wants us to do. But we're always human in the middle of all of that. So even our churches change as the generations go by. Whether it's the decorations or the music or the liturgy, the order of things that we do, the translation of the Bible that we read, all those things change. What the focus is, are we all about small groups? Are we all about a seeker-sensitive attraction type of service on Sunday morning? Are we all about growing or externally with numbers? Are we growing internally with spiritual growth in our personal lives? All those different focuses are all good, like the culture, but they're usually correctives to the one that came before, and the pendulum keeps swinging, and we try this, and then we try this, and then we try it over here, and then it's like a three-dimensional pendulum that swings in all different directions. Even our theology changes as it interacts with culture, as we see that the grid that people used to develop their theology depended on culture, which now we know that culture has passed us by. It's over there somewhere, and we've seen what's wrong with it, so now we have to redo that grid, which means it changes our theology. So how we, and a theology is basically a way of taking the gospel and our relationship with God and trying to put it into a series of grids, maybe boxes, and just so we can explain it clearly. It's very logical and clear, but our theologies are also human products. So the good news never changes, but as the culture changes, Jesus sees the mistakes in the culture and has the corrective response to it. As the church styles and traditions change, Jesus sees them and says, okay, that's good, but this is what you need to hear from me. And as our theologies change, He says, you know, you got that right. I'm excited you got that right, but this part, you didn't get. Every time something new comes over the horizon, because Jesus is perfect, He has the answer to the mistakes that we have made. Every day, I start a new day and I have a plan. And like Mike Tyson said, everybody has a plan until they get punched in the mouth. And the world is full of boxers these days. And Jesus sees our plan and says, my son, my daughter, that is a great idea. Those are great plans, but I have something to say to you about it. And there's this that you need to focus on. Now, if this was the United States Constitution, or the Pharisees' 600 and some laws, we would be able to organize our life in such a way that we just did it right all the time. And anything that we the Constitution left out, or that the laws of the Pharisees left out, you got away with it, it's fine, you're still righteous. And Jesus pointed that out to the Pharisees very explicitly. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. Jesus isn't a list of rules. The gospel is Jesus. He's a person. And when people tried to get him to give a specific set of answers, he told them stories. When people wanted it to nail him down and say this or that, he asked a question. Jesus is not someone who gave us the textbook. He's a person. And the answer is always, go talk to Jesus. Go listen to Jesus. The stories of Jesus are stories about the character of God and what he thinks is important. And that's new every morning. That's new when I wake up and I have a plan, because it's a human plan. That's new when our church meets, as the board meets, and we make a decision. When the congregation meets and we have a discussion, we make some decisions. We have votes. Even that process is something that humans came up with that God has an opinion about. Our culture tries to correct for things. And you know, we should celebrate the things in our culture that are in line with the kingdom. We should celebrate the fact that racism is not okay anymore. And we should celebrate the fact that we want to take care of the least of these. But Jesus has many answers for our culture. Where we need, the culture needs to, I mean, culture isn't putting itself under Jesus' authority. But we are. So we can speak to the culture the way Jesus did. The church, how we do church, our traditions, we find a way that works. It's got a lot of human in it. It's not perfect. It lasts for a while. But I read a book 30 years ago, 25 years ago. And it talked, one of the phrases that it said is the continuing conversion of the church. Because the church continually needs to meet this Jesus and not be satisfied with the rules. We are not supposed to write a set of rules that give us the answers for how to live. We're supposed to go back to Jesus. So, new wine, new wineskins. Jesus is always talking about himself when he's talking about the kingdom. Because the kingdom is a personal loyalty to Him. He wants to give us new gifts. And He wants us to be able to accept new gifts. As soon as we make a list of rules, as soon as we codify it into an algorithm, as soon as we say, now, I know how to live the way God wants me to live, I just have to do these things. And we have taken our relationship with Jesus and set it aside and said, no, this is more important. Or this is what He cares about. And you know what? I'll ask Him when I'm confused, but most of the time I can just follow these rules. New wine. New wineskins. We cannot be tied to anything but our relationship with Jesus.
Amen.
And He's asking us. He's asking us for His loyalty. There's a lot of challenges in our world. Obviously, COVID is a huge challenge. I'm looking at a bunch of masks and a bunch of empty pews. The election is happening. That's a challenge. How are we supposed to obey God in the middle of our democracy? I'm looking at farmers here, and I know that it's, you know, every year is a new challenge with the weather and with the prices. And you're always looking to see how is God going to provide. I preached off notes off of this little thing. We've got these fancy gadgets. I left my phone back there so it wouldn't bug me. We're broadcasting over Facebook and YouTube will get the broadcast right after the service. The radio is broadcasting. The world is full of these amazing, magical technologies. But the idea was always that it was going to lead to a better culture, but it has just exposed our humanness. And all of those things that come over the horizon, Jesus is always ready to respond. And it's a new answer every time. Because the questions that each of those changes ask are different. So, the lesson for us is to stay loyal to Jesus and not to our understanding of Jesus. If I'm defending my theology, that means that I'm defending something that's my understanding of what Jesus said. If I'm defending Jesus, I'm saying, look, I don't speak for Him. I can tell you what I heard. I'm a witness. I can tell you what He did for me. But, and I will defend His honor and His name, and I will go to the death for His honor, not for mine, not for my understanding. And God is going to respond to that loyalty.
Amen.
With the blessings of the kingdom. And when He wants to describe the blessings of the kingdom, He doesn't talk about blessings being that you will have strength and you will be able to, I mean, yes, you will have strength, you will be able to withstand the storms, but when He gives you His blessing, the story is always about a party. It's about a feast. It's about fruitfulness. It's about wine. And that's why this parable comes back to one of the things that we shouldn't forget. It's sort of a coloring of the parable. It's not the main point. But he chose those words carefully. God wants to bless us in a way that makes sense to us. It makes us joyful. It fills us so we don't feel empty. I'm not saying that he's going to make everyone healthy and wealthy. But he knows you. And he wants to give you joy. Not the things that we rely on to give us joy. He wants us to depend on him, and he will give us joy. So the good news is actually good news. The good news of the gospel is not sad. It's not depressing. It requires us to lay aside our old wineskins. But he is calling us to enjoy his feast that he wants to give us. I'm going to invite Aidan to come up and sing a closing song, and then I will pray a benediction, and we can go out and enjoy the kingdom of God. Enjoy being personally loyal to Jesus this week.
Thank you.
lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, Your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Jesus, thank You for being our good shepherd. Thank You for coming and rescuing us even though we are wayward sheep. Thank You for preparing a home for us. Thank You for leading us to green pastures and still waters. Lord, may we always be loyal to You in our words, in our actions, in our thoughts. And we ask for Your blessing on us because we need it. We cannot make it without You. We are not able to survive on our own. We need You. We thank You that You have offered Yourself to us far sooner than we asked for our help. This week, Lord, go with us. And we ask You just to keep Your promises to us. And help us, Lord, to be faithful to You this week. In Jesus' name, amen. You are dismissed.